Okay, very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Kansai University for organizing this meaningful event and also organizing this student workshop or summer school. It's really good to have encouraged the higher education, and that is my whole discussion today. And this is one of the activities also supporting that. I really appreciate your activities, and thank you so much for inviting me to address this gathering. Very briefly, in 1 minute possibly, I'll try to brief about my institute. Last year, Kansai University group also visited AIT, located in Thailand. It's also an international institute. We are having 70% students from outside Thailand. So we have one program called Disaster Preparedness Mitigation and Management. It is a postgraduate program, primarily master's and PhD. And it's most importantly, it's interdisciplinary program between science and technology and also the social sciences. And we are trying to incorporate the entrepreneurs and NGOs and internship with the private sector as well. These are the broad academic programs in our course curriculum. So we are doing postgraduate mostly, certificate programs, masters, professional masters, and also PhD. So I feel like there is a good chance between Kansai University and AIT to develop some longer cooperation. So as you can see, this disaster management program also started in 2008 in Thailand, and catering to is about 21 country students still so far participated as a in different courses. Apart from the regular courses, we also organize quite large conference with many countries and participants. So it's 2017, we organized one big conference with 24 plus countries and about 140 participants across 24 countries. This year also we organized a conference. Its primary focus was resilience and DRR. As you can see, it's also country participating from 1962 universities participated in the whole event. So that is one of the milestone we are developing, and as you can see, this is one of the key activity we are doing. We had done actually with UN University Tokyo and ProsperNet group, apart from other universities across many region. Some publications from our site as a book volume, apart from the journal articles. Couple of books are also in pipeline, so maybe in due course of time I will share. So to start with, we need to know, like, and our group number four, as I remember, like, they have done something on education, but primarily focused on the school education. But we need to discuss a little bit on the higher education, so college and universities, what they are doing on the DRR and SDGs. It's important context on the quality education is foster creativity. So unless we have quality education or meaningful education in disaster context and sustainable development, so it's difficult to propagate or develop the preparedness. This is quite interesting because, as you know, SDG is a quite vast. It's about 17 goals and about thousands of indicators to measure the SDGs at the country level. So to develop a little bit of contextualize with the education, we have seen, like, this is quite interesting to make in a three blocks. So all these SDGs can club into three blocks, and in SFDRR also we have seen a couple of priorities, four priorities, so we can link up. This also very much known figure, like, there are about eight areas where directly these factors are directly influencing the resilience and decreasing the disaster risk. So if we can link up with the SDGs, SDG educations and DRR education, taking the context from these two, then possibly our education system will be robust. So we did some sort of gap analysis across 25 universities in the region. I'll show you some of the graphs from the real data, what we collected from 25 universities. And also from the DRR experts. So what we observed, like, there is a lack of proper market research. So normally that course design is say for University A, University B, the best faculties, what they are expertise in, we are developing programs and course based on that. It's not necessarily we are targeting the demand, what is the requirement from the government side or the society, and designing course based on that. Lack of real multi and transdisciplinary education in the master and PhD level. So we are talking about multidisciplinary, but in reality, there are many technical issues among the universities as well to develop the real transdisciplinary and multidisciplinary program. Lack of mindset of the teaching staff on multi and transdisciplinary. So we call like, I'm the core department is civil, but I'm teaching in disaster. Core department is architecture, but I'm teaching in disaster, like this. So still our core department in existence, but I think we need to change a little bit of mindset also as a transdisciplinary, to develop the multidisciplinary and transdisciplinary programs. A lack of institutional policy and mechanism. We studied with about 25 universities and we checked there is a lack of this institutional policy and mechanism to encourage the multidisciplinary program. I'm not saying it's wrong, but maybe we need a little bit more effort on that. And next is the most important component, it's a job opportunity for the students, the students who are doing master's or PhD in disaster management, what is the job aspect after that? So this couple of things we have done with this Higher Education Institute Disaster Resilience and Sustainable Development Network. So we started last year in 2018 and developed about a network for 25 universities. Those who are running disaster related programs and sustainable development related programs in the region. So this is the map, and this about 60%, these are the responses we got, and the network also we developed for the higher education institutes, those who are contributing for the DRR and SDG education. Since it's mostly voluntary involvement, so it's not the comprehensive data. So it's a very selective data from 25 countries, 25 universities. This is interesting to see, like what type of degree they are offering. So about 58% of the universities responded are offering masters, and about 38 also undergrads and doctoral programs at the responded universities. And the right side is much more important, is the disaster risk management courses. What type of courses they are offering? If the course is related to earthquake or flood-related things, hydrometeorological disasters, or what? So we have seen large number of courses are focused on earthquake-related things, earthquake, all geophysical hazards. I'm showing you the institutional perspective, response from the institutes who are teaching disaster management. Technical skill development courses, we have given certain questionnaires to the responders, and the response is quite interesting. If you see, like, geoinformatics is one of the most responded context. So most of the institutes are having expertise and they are offering this geoinformatics and remote sensing. Soft skill related things is also important. We are discussing yesterday also among our faculty groups. Like the communication skill, leadership skills, and monitoring and evaluation, and statistical analysis to do the social context and social sciences part. This particular slide will give you some sort of more institutional perspective. I have given a very short, abridged version of this analysis. We are publishing a paper and on one report also under publication. So right now we have not published all this data. Is under consideration of the PROSPANET group. Next, to deal with the whole process of our cross-learning and the student mobility and all this, what type of scholarships are available for the student mobility? How many national scholarship we can avail, how many international scholarship we can avail, and so we have tried to map all these issues for that particular, and we are trying to scale up, actually. And then faculty exchange programs, these are the percentage of the institutes responded, and the involvement in disaster related activities. This is very important, like whether our faculties and students are really involved in the disaster management activities, like during disaster or after disaster or pre-disaster or not, or only teaching and research. So that is important to see. This is the response from the DRR experts. The 150 participants participated in the conference this year. We took some sort of survey, and about 87 number of people responded. So this is the response from 87%. 87 DRR experts, either they are teaching or doing research on disaster risk reduction and SDGs. So we got very interesting insight. The economic growth and livelihood options. So they are interested to do this type of courses. And also the research interest on the SFDRR, these two are two different parts. Like one is on the SDG with DRR, another is also only Sendai framework or DRR related programs. This is the last one possibly for the response. What are the preferred method? I think many of the students also will agree that right now the methods you are going through for the teaching and also the faculties, I think like the preferred method of instruction as per the present situation right now, the reflection is they need more hybrid programs. Like some programs need online and contact courses, and so these are the distribution of the response from the experts. And also the challenges in the present curriculum. What are the challenges we are facing? It's quite interesting, not enough space for the technical skill development and only based on the theory and classroom teaching. So we need to link our classroom teaching theoretical aspects to the field related things. Either they are developing some live project, or they are involved with some live project, or something with a government agency or other agency. So this is, I think, I was willing to share with you. Our last two slides is from some of the international reports. Emerging trend and challenges and changes that affect the education sectors in development. So we got some interesting figure. If you see, like in 1990s, the Asia Pacific region constituted roughly about 21% of the world's GDP. And then it's increasing. Okay. And if you get the projection, it's going up to 51% of the global GDP for the region. I'm talking about the ASEAN region. So this is the projection from the World Bank 2014 data. And this is interesting too. We need to see the disaster management more seriously in the region. The next part is the technological advancement. We got 6 billion people globally out of 7 point something whole population gained access to the mobile phones, and 3 billion people to the internet. So as mentioned by some of the group members from the summer school also, like right now, we need to think more on a digital aspect. So this is one of the key issues we need to focus on the education also, to make the lifelong and life-wide learning, not only the teaching in the classroom. The third part is the demographic changes. This part is very, very crucial for our coordination and cooperation and students also. Like Asia Pacific region, about 60% world largest share of the youth population. That is significant. 60% world youth is residing in Asia. The second part is higher education sector is expected to be particularly affected by the mobility rates from the of the students, international students. Okay, so this is one of the good part and also the bad part. So this is the mobility has increased for last couple of years. Another notable demographic pattern is the Asia Pacific region is the urbanization. So many of the people are moving from the rural to urban. We know the urban population now is increasing more than 50%. And the continual disaster and conflict. So the conflict areas are also affected, the schools and the universities in education context. And the diversity and interconnectedness. This is one of the key issues to address the inequality and also the gender issues here. The region's diversity in many aspects like demographic tradition, cultures also changes. Like the country which are affected more by the disasters, their disaster and risk culture is different than the country which are not affected very frequently. So I think some of the summer school group also addressed this point. This is one of the interesting thing on the education challenges. Why we are discussing this? There are certain challenges we have seen. The right side charts, if you see, there's a large number of illiterate persons. there are large number of, just last slide, okay, sorry, little bit exceeded. Large number of illiterate person, globally around 250 million children are not learning the basic things. So we discuss about the school education, and about the 65% of the world's adult illiterate population. This is the data from the UNESCO statistics. Also, we can check the report. So this is one of the key figure, like 65% of the world adult is illiterate. So we are trying to enhance that number also. So we need to little bit think more. This is the last one. What we need to do? What next? So let's move forward with more internal and transboundary joint curriculum. So in that way, the Kansai University is doing the first one and a couple of points. So I really appreciate this with my slide as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you.